Hello again, everybody. Along with Don Sutton, Skip Caray welcoming you to another night of Atlanta Braves baseball from Dodgers Stadium. Braves and Dodgers, a three-game series opens tonight. When all this started 7 games ago, the Braves were hopeful of really making up some ground on the Dodgers and on the Reds. It hasn't worked out that way. We've won 2 and lost 5 of those crucial games. So the Braves have to do well in this series. It's almost time to call it crucial, Don.
Well, it's going to be even tougher this weekend, too, Skip. The Dodgers have 3 right-handers going against the Braves, who, as you know, are missing the left-handed punch of Justice and Bream. And I think anytime you have to face a Belcher, a Martinez, and a Hershiser, your work is cut out for you. Normally, the All-Star break is the accepted halfway point of the baseball season. 8.5 games back is not that far to catch up, but it is always good to go into that 3-day rest with something positive, and 2 out of 3 or 3 out of here would do it.
Tom Glavine, the Braves ace, will be on the mound against Tim Belcher tonight, and back with the starting lineups right after this.
Welcome back to Dodger Stadium, the first of 3 Braves visiting the Dodgers, the last 3 games before the All-Star break, and here's the starting lineup in game 1 for Bobby Cox. Otis Nixon will lead off and play right field. Deion Sanders gets the start in left field, bat 2nd. Terry Pendleton will hit 3rd and play 3rd base. Batting cleanup and playing center field, it's Ron Gant. Jeff Blauser, who has turned this first half of the season into a good one for him, is at shortstop. He'll hit 5th. Again, it's Mike Bell at first base. Greg Olson behind the plate. And getting a start at 2nd base tonight, it's Mark Lemke. And on the mound, the Braves representative to the All-Star game, left-hander Tom Glavine. Defensively, the Dodgers will line up with Cal Daniels, Brett Butler, and Daryl Strawberry, the outfield. Sharperson, Griffin, Samwell, and Murray will be the infield. Carter is behind the plate, and on the mound, the right-hander Tim Belcher. Belcher lifetime 5-1 with a 2.06 earned run average. You can see he has an impressive earned run average. Has made a lot of the starts for the Dodgers, 16 to be exact. Doesn't surrender many home runs, and pretty good control. He, more than any other Dodgers, has had to pitch through the Dodgers' defensive woes. That's why the record is only 7-4. The umpires for the series, starting out with tonight's game, we'll see Terry Tata behind the plate. Jerry Crawford will be at first base. Ed Rapuano is at 2nd, and Bill Hahn is at 3rd base. Braves need to play well here. It sounds like something we have said before almost every series for the last 3. But as we pointed out in the open, 8.5, not that far back. It would be nice to come out of here with at least 2 out of 3. Well, we're about set to kick it off. And here to take you half the way, once again, it's Skip Caray.
Okay, Don, thanks very much. In the other baseball, the Mets lead Philadelphia 3-1 as the Phillies bat in the 9th. But John Franco has gone in relief of Doc Gooden. Montreal has a 4-3 lead over Pittsburgh there in the 8th inning. Dennis Martinez against John Smiley. The Cubs 3-1 over St. Louis after 5. Frank Castillo against Jose De Leon. Cincinnati 1-0 over Houston after 6. Hammond against Harnish. San Diego and San Francisco about to get started. In the American League, Baltimore leads the Yankees 5-4. That's at the end of 6 innings. Milwaukee has the lead over Cleveland as the Indians bat in the 9th. Boston beat Detroit 10-1. Kevin Morton got the win, Walt Terrell the loser. White Sox lead Minnesota 4-1 after 7. Texas 5-0 over California behind Jose Guzman. Oakland winning big at Kansas City. Jose Canseco, a grand slam, is 21st. And Toronto and Seattle about to get started. Here, we're about to get started, and Otis Nixon will lead it up, hitting 323. No homers, 11 RBIs, 0-for-6 lifetime against Tim Belcher. Sharperson in close at 3rd, Murray at 1st, and we're underway, and the fastball is a strike on the outside corner.
Belcher starting this off like he typically likes to. He likes to get strike 1 on the outer half of the plate with his fastball.
Starter to bunt, pulled the bat back. Gary Carter wants to make sure, counting them at 1-1. Braves lead the league in runs scored at 351, second in batting average at 263. But struggling at the moment. The 1-1 pitch. Chopped foul back. It's a ball and 2 strikes. A capacity crowd here in Dodger Stadium tonight. They had a big fireworks display after the game. They have the character from the movie Rocketeer here, but what a bummer he didn't blast off. No. The 1-2 pitch. He bunts, and that's strike 3. So Nixon is out, and that's the way the game starts. Tried to bunt his way on with two strikes, automatically a strikeout. Odd start. Here's Sander.
Well, he's the kind of guy that can do that. He is that good of a bunter. His only mistake was trying to make a perfect bunt. The infield had all moved back with two strikes, and anything not right at Belcher would have been a base hit.
Deion Sanders is the batter, hitting 192, two homers, eight RBIs. Since being recalled, he's 3 out of 17. Sharperson even with a bag at third this time. And the bunt is that way. A two hopper. The throw is going to get him. Two down. Pretty good play by Sharperson. I said he was even with a bag, but as the pitcher delivered, he was taking a step in. And so when he shortened a bunt, he was able to wander in quickly.
Yeah, he cut down the distance that this bunt would have traveled by 8 or 10 feet. And if you look at the play at first base, he nips Sanders by maybe about 4 feet. So his movement on the square by Sanders was the difference to get him out.
In his last 11 games, Terry Pendleton hitting .444 for the year, .324. Well, let somebody try to hit the ball.
Pendleton was doing that in batting practice. He was wearing out the right field pavilion. But then again, Belcher wasn't throwing batting practice, was he?
No. Fastball a little bit inside. One ball, no strikes. Check swing, foul back.
Well, there are a number of players in that category. One just down the freeway is Fred McGriff. He was left off of it. And over in the American League, Joe Carter. There's always, seems to be six or seven, you can make a valid case for their being on the All-Star team. One of the controversies would have been Eddie Murray over Fred McGriff.
The 1-1. Gets away from Carter, rolls away. It's two balls and a strike. The Braves do have a second delegate to the All-Star game, and we're very happy about that. Trainer Dave Persley will be one of the two National League trainers. He and Tom Glavine leave after the game Sunday. They have, I think it's a 10 o'clock flight, get into Toronto at 6 a.m. Monday.
And probably have a workout, which is almost always mandatory.
The 2-1 pitch. High chop. Griffin backs up. It's going to be a close play. The throw gets away into the dugout, so the runner will go to second. It'll doubtless be a hit and an error. You knew Griffin was in trouble when he backed up on that ball.
He had to make a choice of coming in and playing the shortstop or the short hop, or hope that he could get enough on his throw to throw him out after playing the big bounce. Got the big bounce. It would have been bang bang anyway, but they're going to get Pendleton a base hit. He'll go to second on the error, the overthrow that caused the ball to go into the dugout.
And it gives Ron again a chance to drive in a run. Time is called here now. Tom Lasorda's coming out to check on something. Maybe the argument is whether or not the ball went into the dugout, but it did.
Yeah, it went all the way past the railing. That's the question. Jerry Crawford's going to short circuit this argument. There is a camera well down there, and it bounced past the camera well. Eddie Murray's going to explain to his manager what happened, and then we'll see what the ruling is. There you see the camera wells, just the other side of the dugout. But it didn't hit the rail. If it hit the rail out front and stayed out there, then you run at your own risk. But if it passes that rail, normally that allows you to take the extra base.
Now Tommy and Crawford talk it over again.
In my judgment, it went past the rail. It bounced off the wall. And the longer you're out here, the longer we delay the fireworks show.
That's true.
And again, checking with Eddie Murray, his version is not going to change.
The discussion continues now. Tommy is satisfied, or as satisfied as he's likely to get. And he trots off the field. And Ronnie Gant stands in there. Gant, 3 out of 15 in his career against Tim Belcher. He's still at .231 for the year, but in his last 32 games, he's hit at a .282 clip, which is about what you would expect and hope he would hit for the year. There's nothing wrong with his production, as you can see. He's on pace for a 30 homer year with 85 RBIs or thereabouts, and if he keeps swinging the bat as he has in the last month, he could do better than that.
When you spend 3 or 4 weeks at 190 or so, it takes a lot of weeks at 280 to push that up.
Breaking ball drilled deep center field. Back goes Butler. He's at the wall. He leaps. He can't make the catch. A run is in. How far can Gant go? He races for third. He will hold up there with a triple, and let's see if Butler's all right. He went banging into the wall at the 395-foot mark, and his left hand is hurting him. That's his glove hand.
Belcher went against his normal pitching style to Gant, started him off with a breaking ball. Looked like Gant might have been setting on it, drove it a long way. Watch Butler go up, and he'll jam that arm into the wall, and looked like he may have jammed it in there hard. Take a look from this angle. His glove hand will hit the wall, but the left hand will come up right
batting
there
number
and bang the back of it against
Shortstop.
The wall.
Jeff.
Anyway, the Braves are
Blauser.
On board first.
And Gant is at third with two out, and Jeff Blauser hitting 283 is the batter. One out of 16 in his career against Belcher, but Pendleton was 3 out of 14, and Gant 3 out of 15, and they did all right. Blauser fouls the first pitch back. It's 0-1. In his last 34 games, Blauser has driven in 26 runs. He has been one of the hottest hitters in baseball.
He's also attracting a lot of interest in both leagues, a lot of scouts following the Braves. This seems to be the name right here that keeps popping up in conversation.
0-2 is the count. It seems like it might be about time for the Braves to make a big decision. They're either going to have to play this guy, or somewhere along the line, he's going to say, hey, it was let me out of here, or their hand's going to be forced because they're going to get a great offer. The 0-2 almost hit him inside. Good play by Carter. A ball and two strikes.
Well, you have two values as a ball player, Skip. Number one is what you can produce for the club that you're playing with, or number two is what you can bring in return. And as you see, when you list the four most productive RBIs per at-bat ratio, Blauser right in the middle of it. An RBI every five times up.
And it's skewed a little bit. Brian Hunter hasn't batted that many times. Fair of outside.
But Blauser is a guy that a lot of people would stick at third, short, second, and leave him every day. And I believe if he played all year, he would produce 20 home runs and maybe about a 275 or 280 batting average.
The 2-2 pitch. Swung, and there's a fly ball to deep center, but not quite deep enough. Butler goes back. Makes the play, and the inning is over. The Braves get a run on two hits. There was an error, and a runner was left. Bottom of the first rolls round. Braves won. Dodgers come to bat.
Board first. Dodgers coming up, and here's how they'll line up. Leading off it in center field, it'll be Brett Butler. Juan Samuel is at second base and hitting second. Darryl Strawberry's back in the lineup. He'll bat third, play right field. The cleanup man, Eddie Murray. Cal Daniels will hit fifth. He'll be in left. Gary Carter, a little hitting streak of his own going, will catch and bat sixth. Mike Sharperson gets a start at third. Alfredo Griffin is at short, and Tim Belcher will bat ninth. For the Braves defensively, it'll be Sanders, Gant, Nixon, a lot of speed in the outfield. Pendleton, Blauser, Lemke, and Bell, the infield. Olson behind the plate, and Tom Glavine on the mound. There you see his numbers, and since April 19th, Tom Glavine has averaged right at 8 innings a start. The 11-4 record could very easily be 14-1.
He's second in the league in ERA, 2.06, tied for first in wins with Ramon Martinez at 11. First in complete games with 5, 8th in innings pitched, 118. Third in strikeouts, 98. Not too shabby. Brett Butler, who's going to play in his first All-Star game, will lead it off. He's hit 18 in a row. High chop, headed for left field, base hit. Well, the Braves had him played right, but he slapped one through there anyway, and he's now hitting 19 in a row.
Takes advantage of the defense. Pendleton in, had to guard against the bunt. He just slapped this on the ground.
Second baseman.
About 6 inches out of the reach of Terry Pendleton, and how many times has Brett Butler done that? You can also bet in front of home plate here at Dodger Stadium. They have packed it down and tamped it down real well, just so Butler can do that.
Juan Samuel is the batter. Butler is 19 out of 32 in the stolen base department. Samuel having a super year, 318. And he's murdered Tom Glavine, 10 out of 27 against him. One of those 10 hits a homer. Butler edges away to the plate. He took a shot at right field, didn't get it, 0-1.
I bet you most of that hitting has come against the old Tom Glavine, the one that threw the 82-mile-an-hour turnover fastball in the changeup. Samwell chases the ball upstairs, but he drives the ball that is down just below the belt to the knees, and he's a pretty good off-speed hitter if you leave it in the strike zone.
Tom Glavine, by the way, wants to wish Jennifer McBride a happy birthday. Samwell checks out Joe Malfitano as third base coach. Throw to first, runner back.
Butler has 19 steals, as you pointed out, but most of that has come against right-handers, Skip. He has had a little bit of difficulty when the lefty is on the mound.
0-1 is the count. Right through there, and Glavine quickly in front, 0-2.
Have you noticed when Tom Glavine pitches this year, you see a lot of right-handers who take that fastball because they're obviously used to seeing something else. And although you have it in a scouting report, most hitters are skeptics. They want to see it before they'll believe it.
After you have it proved to them in person. To first, Butler back easily. 0-2, the count. Samwell, 96 hits already. And he scored 47 runs. He's had a heck of a year.
Here comes that four-seam fastball in and up.
And he got him with it. Samwell out on strikes, first out of the inning. 99th strikeout for Glavine. Here's Darryl Strawberry.
Here's that four-seam fastball. As we pointed out, Samwell likes to hit the ball down, but he has trouble laying off the fastball up. He's in the 60s with his strikeouts now.
Darryl Strawberry at 223, eight homers, one of them last night. He's had a terrible time against Tom Glavine, 1 out of 18. They don't think that Strawberry can pull Glavine. Throw to first, runner back. Another big Braves fan, Dorothy Hornickel, down in St. Petersburg, celebrating a birthday tonight.
And I think that's an accurate assessment defensively. Strawberry will pull off-speed stuff, but the good fastball, his power is almost always straight away.
Boy, they came in with that pitch, 0-1. Darryl out of the batter's box. Olson set up outside, but the pitch zipped over the inside corner. Into the dirt, Olson a good play. Count evens, 1-1. Eddie Murray is on deck. Strawberry was the leading vote getter for the National League All-Star team, but is going to pass it up to give his ailing shoulder a little more rest. There's your on-deck hitter. A ball and a strike is the count. To first, he's back easily. John Smoltz against Oral Hershiser tomorrow night. Charlie Liebrand against Ramon Martinez on Sunday. Dennis Martinez pitched and pitched well tonight. It will be either he or Glavine who starts for the National League in the All-Star game. Glavine 1-0 this year, 5-7 lifetime against the Dodgers.
Come on down.
Breaking ball just missed that outside corner, 2-1. Now, if Butler is of a mind to do some running, this would be a pretty good pitch to do it, 2-1. Tommy Lasorda, by the way, becomes 27th on the all-time list games managed. 2,292. It passes Joe Cronin. But he'll never get to be number one.
How many is that?
Connie Mack, 7,679 games. You got to own the team to go that long. The 2-1.
Line left field, base hit.
Sanders fields it on one hop. So Strawberry went the other way and hit a bullet. And a struggling hitter comes to the plate. Eddie Murray, four for his last 44.
Eddie Murray.
And that's one of the things Darryl Strawberry and Ben Hines have been working on. That's taking that pitch the other way and not being so pull conscious. And the conversation goes something like, you're strong enough to hit it out anywhere. Take the pitch the way it's pitched.
Tying run at second. Go ahead, run at first. One out here. The fastball by him. He fouled it off his ear into the second deck, 0-1. Talk about the Dodgers' punch with Strawberry and Sam Well and those guys. The reason they're where they are, their team earned run average is 2.92. They've given up the fewest runs, 255. The fewest earned runs, 225. They've struck out the most, 491 men. Their pitchers have dominated. They bluffed back, but Butler was standing right on the bag. Murray with 8 homers, 50 RBIs. Now he steps out of the box. They play him straight away in the outfield. Double play ball, maybe. Good play, Pendleton. Out there. Out there. 5-4-3 double play. Good play by Bell. A better play by Pendleton on the short hop to his left. And the pitcher's best friend gets Atlanta out of trouble in the bottom of the first. Two hits, no runs, no errors, a runner left. At the end of an inning, Atlanta 1, Los Angeles nothing. We go to the second inning. Mike Bell will lead it off. He's hitting .267, which since coming up, a homer, one RBI. 1-0 Atlanta. You know, you talk about the errors the Braves have made, and they've made a bunch, but they've also made some plays, like Pendleton just made there, that a year ago would not have been made. So even if the errors are about the same, the defense is improved. Not as good as the Braves would like it to be, but better than it was. The 0-1 pitch. Chase one down at the shoetops. It's 0-2.
Well, they're getting to a lot of balls that the defensive alignment the last 2 years would not have gotten to. And most of those errors are coming on throws for some reason.
The 0-2 pitch. Fly ball, center field. Butler in a couple of steps. One away in the Atlanta second. Here's Greg Olson.
Seven. Number 10. Catcher.
He is a streaky hitter. And sometimes that's good, sometimes it's not. Right now he's streaking in the other direction, just three of his last 25 in his last eight games.
Oh, that's neat.
They have an electronic pencil sharpener here. I don't think I've ever seen one of those. Fastball on the outside corner, 0-1.
I'll be amused the rest of the night. Just don't sharpen your pen with it.
I started it. A smoggy day in Los Angeles, the pitch. 1-1. Was it as bad today as I think it was?
You know, it's all relative. Normally, if you're a resident here, when it's yellow, you say it's not as bad as it was yesterday when it was brown.
The pitch. Hit foul to the right.
It was only slightly yellow today.
1-2 is the count. Got him. May have foul tipped that ball, but he's out of there. Second strikeout for Belcher. Two down in the second. You almost feel like you can say in all seriousness to Glavin, there's your run, now go hold him. Because this guy's a tough pitcher. Mark Lemke hitting at .250. He's 0 for 8 in his career against Mr. Belcher. The That was a strike right in there. It's 0-1. We're with you tomorrow night, I think a half hour early. That'll be 10 o'clock Eastern time. We were moaning and groaning about how late we got in. I think we got to the hotel about 5:30 Eastern time. We beat the Dodgers in that 4.5-hour game in San Diego and then had the bus home. Fly ball, short left center, left field. Daniels makes the play and the inning is over. 1-2-3, nothing doing. Bottom half of the second inning coming up. Atlanta leads at 1-0.
Business here in televises shows you those same three palm trees. They've been there for a long time. We're going to jump right along with it, too. Well, I read the disclaimer. This telecast is authorized under broadcasting right granted by the Atlanta National League Baseball Club and is intended solely for the entertainment of our audience. Any publication, rebroadcast, retransmission, or other use of the pictures, descriptions, or accounts of this game without the express written consent of the Atlanta National League Baseball Club is prohibited with or without the palm tree. You rented a car, are there, right? Yes, I rented a car.
And you still have friends who own homes and live out here, right?
I know some people who own homes and live out here.
Any of them got chainsaws? We might have to do a little midnight maintenance around Dodger Stadium. I'm sick of those projects.
Midnight logging?
Yeah. Cal Daniels will lead off the bottom of the second. Glavin hung a curveball high and inside. One ball, no strikes. Daniels 6 out of 15 in his career against Tommy Glavin. In fact, you look at the record and the way all these guys have hit against Glavin, you think he doesn't have a chance. He's 5-7 against him in his career. But the last couple of years, he's pitched much better baseball than Mr. Dodger. Sharp breaking curve, but it missed outside.
Well, his record against the Dodgers this year is pretty much typical of the way his year has gone. 17 innings, one run, but he's got a one win and one no decision.
Out in front of the change, chopped a foul, and the count evens at 2-2. Gary Carter is next. Well, what a story he is. Mike Socha's got a bad hand. He's hit with a pitch, has some pain and some swelling, and Carter has stepped in and played like he was 25 years old. The 2-2 to Daniel. Boy, Olsen held it there, but I guess a little low at a full count, 3-2. Little number into short left field. He made a good pitch on him, but good hitters hit good pitches. He didn't hit it hard, but he hit it hard enough.
Having to count three balls and two strikes gives you the luxury, if you're a hitter, of looking for a pitch to hit. And that happened to be a fastball up. It happened to be a good pitch, but not all base hits come on bad pitches.
Gary Carter has hit in 12 straight games. During that time, he's hitting .340. 6 out of 18 in his career against Tom Glavin. He got the double to drive in a run against Glavin last weekend in Atlanta. In a game the Dodgers eventually won, both Belcher and Glavin pitched brilliant. Neither got a decision. The change on the corner, 0-1.
Well, Gary's had knee problems, you remember, and he got hold of the workout program that Bob Boone had probably about the last 5 years of his career, and Boone had caught till he was 43. It's a program with light weights and exercises, and he does it 45 minutes a night, every other night, even if you catch. And it's really made a difference for Gary Carter.
The 0-1 fouled it back, and he's in the hole 0-2. He took a shot at right field there.
A number of guys use the program, but very few of them credit Mr. Boone with it, but he's the first guy I ever saw do it.
Tell you what, it's amazing what's happening now with athletes. If they want to, with all that they've learned about aerobics and weight training and the like, and other forms of conditioning, the karate and the kung fu and all those things, a lot of guys are hanging around longer, and at these prices, why not?
And the ones who do it and hang around successfully are the ones who find out about it before they turn 35.
Breaking ball out in front, hit it foul to left.
Turning 35 and deciding after not working out that hard for the previous 17 or 18 years and saying, well, I think I'll kick it in right now, doesn't work that well.
So you're not recommending it for me?
No, I think it would work very well.
I think you could prolong your longevity as an announcer by 6 or 8 years.
I couldn't do
and
that.
At your prices, that'd be a good deal for you.
Couldn't do that to the public. 0-2, the count. I think I'll retire and just do a talk show every night.
The 0-2 pitch.
Got it. The change. Second strikeout.
Set him up nicely with some outside fastballs, and then here's the change. Same motion as the fastball, same arm speed, but about 10 miles an hour slower and with good movement.
Mike Sharperson, the batter.
Radio or TV?
It doesn't matter.
I do both.
Can I be a guest?
On my show too, sure.
I'm glad to have you.
Glavin comes set to first, runner back. Well, how much money did you guys collect yesterday? Don, did you ever figure it out?
Well, Coke.
The final word?
Well, Coke put up $1 million, but I think there was 520 of it. There was something, I believe, 104 home runs hit yesterday in all of baseball.
Line, right field, fair ball into the corner. Let's see how far Daniels can get. He's got the bad wheels. They're going to hold him at third. A solidly hit double for Mike Sharperson. He is a good-looking young player. Glavin in trouble again, but he's got the number 8 hitter coming to the plate.
He's definitely the Rodney Dangerfield of the Dodgers. Hits well, unselfish ball player, can do that as well as anybody on the roster. Can play third, can play second, he can play short, but the Dodgers continue to look for players for those three positions.
See how the Braves infield is going to play it here. They're back at short and second. I'm a little surprised at that. Griffin hitting .237 on the year with 15 RBIs. 9 out of 31 in his career against Tom Glavin, so he's hit him okay. Lasorda likes the squeeze play, too. Let's see what happens here. He's swinging. Fly ball, right field. Nixon back. Runner tags. Here's the catch. Here comes Daniels. The throw will come back in. Another runner goes to third. Tie game. Griffin drives in his 16th run with a sacrifice fly to right.
Batting ninth.
And that's another 49. Spot where the absence of justice hurts you. I think Otis Nixon would be the first to tell you he's got no better than an average arm from right field.
And I think he's more comfortable playing center field, too. There's a different angle. That ball sliced, and it looked like it fooled him just long enough for him not to be in the good position to throw.
Pendleton, even with a bag at third. Inside, one ball, no strikes. Belcher hitting 176. He's driven in 2-0.
You know, it might surprise you. That sacrifice fly for Griffin was hit fifth. On the Dodger roster, only Murray has more.
Sliced foul into the seats. And it ricochets all the way down to the front row behind the Atlanta dugout. In there, fastball inside corner. It's 1-2. Glavin has been touched for 4 hits so far and 1 run. The 1-2 pitch got him, and the inning is over. But the Dodgers even the game, a run on 2 hits. They leave 1 at the end of 2 complete. 1-1 is our score.
We're all tied, top of the third. Here's our question of the night. How did the Dodgers ever become the name of a baseball team? And 8-year-old James Hall from St. Simon's Island sent us that. Well, the Dodgers were known as the Robins and the Superbas, but originally they were called the Trolley Dodgers because a trolley ran right outside the park.
If it's field.
And it was shortened to just the Dodgers, but it were originally, and the Dodgers have a long history. They've been around for a long time.
And Tom Glavine leads off the third. Tie ball game. Glavine bunts down the third baseline. It's a good one. And Sharperson, I don't know why he didn't let that ball go. He had no chance to throw him out. A break for Atlanta. Base hit for Glavine, who came in at 278. So the go-ahead run is back on base.
Glavine, Avery, Smoltz, all the pitchers try this every now and then. And I think Sharperson was a little bit undecided here and probably thinking with a pitcher running, he could have gone ahead and made the play anyway. Dandy bunt. Probably would have kicked foul. It used to be automatic. Any bunt here down either line was banked toward the infield. That's all changed in the last few years.
That was that way for Dave Lopes and Maury Wills and those fellas. There's another bunt. The only play will be to first. Low throw, but Murray digs it out. That'll be a sacrifice, though he was bunting for a hit. Nixon is still 0 for 1. It's a 1-3 sack. And Glavine goes.
24.
G-Mock used to call this little ball, and it's a good idea because you're short some of the power. You don't have Bream and you don't have Justice, so you're not going to hit too many three-run homers. But I think being able to move guys around and take advantage of the speed, it's good baseball.
Glavine, who has good running speed at second with one out. 1-1 our score in the third. Strike called inside corner, 0-1. The outfield plays Dion around toward left. A lot of room in right center. And if he should ever hit one into that alley with his speed, it might get a little exciting here. Also some room down the right field line. Butler, as you see, way over in left center field. There's that big hole in right center. One out in the innings. Harry Pendleton waits to hit next. Wild pitch. Runner gets to third. Nobody's covering home plate. Now Belcher, as Glavine comes halfway down the line. Now scampers back.
Good instinctive play by Deion Sanders, too. He figures that was strike three. And since it wasn't, it got past Carter. Watch this. He doesn't hesitate. Carter is definitely crossed up on this. Strike three. Sanders takes off. He's at first.
So that's a strikeout and a fastball.
Boy, has he has really shown some good baseball instincts for a guy who has really played it professionally no more than he has.
So here's Pendleton, and things have really turned around. Instead of two out and a runner at second, which is what you expected out of that play, it's first and third and one out. Pendleton reached on an infield hit his first time. So Belcher is back in the soup, and the little bunt by Tom Glavine started all this.
You hardly ever see a catcher crossed up when you're just using the one sign, like with nobody on or a runner at first. But when a runner gets at second, then you go to a combination, and you'll see that happen probably a dozen times a year for every ball club.
Foul back, 0-1. Terry had a good cutter to high outside fastball. Pendleton, I'll tell you what, the more you're around him, the more you like him. Last night, just walked up to him, said, you know, I'm sorry about that. He said, it's really kind of you. He said, don't worry about it. I feel good about it. I'm having a good year. The ball club's doing all right. And it's not all that phony baloney stuff. He's just that kind of guy. He's proved that all year the way he plays the game.
And talk about good instincts. There's not a whole lot that happens out there on the field that he is not in the middle of, or at least directing traffic.
And you can see it beginning to carry over to other people. He broke contact with the rubber, then threw to first, so an odd play.
I'm just going to throw you over there to let you know I'm over there.
And I'm still thinking about what I want to do with Pendleton, so I'm going to buy myself some time. Terry now at 326 on the year. He's in the hole 0-2. Took a shot at left field that time with a pitch away. Don Sutton, Skip Carey with you from Dodger Stadium. Capacity crowd on it.
Big fireworks show afterwards, which will last quite a while, which means we can beat the crowd.
After tonight, the Dodgers will be at about 1,630,000 people.
It's an amazing city here. It's gotten much like, well, Toronto has gotten like this, where you can turn on the lights just to test the bulbs, and 30,000 will turn out.
The 0-2 pitch. They chase the runner back. Sanders could go at any time. Two is the count. A little chop toward first. Glavin stays. They'll step on the back. Whoa! Murray just barely got back there in time. Glavin came halfway, then didn't force the issue, and it's a good thing he didn't. He'd have been out from here to there. It wasn't hit hard enough to turn the double play.
Well, Murray does a good job here of chasing Glavin back, but one of the reasons that Pendleton almost beat him was that he kept looking at Glavin, and only at the last second was he able to figure out where the bag was. If there hadn't been a runner on first, good chance Glavin would have scored there, but Murray, after coming off with Sanders there, was right in position to make the play.
So it's up to Ronnie Gant, who tripled in Atlanta's first run. His first time. Let's see how they pitch him here. It was a breaking ball he hit, was it not?
Right down the middle.
Second and third, two out. Look out. There's a little candy gram for you. One ball, no strikes.
And the message that was written on it was, if you want to lean out over the plate to get that first pitch breaking ball, have a look at this.
By the way, right as the play was made at first base, Carter went halfway to the mound, said something, and Belcher nodded, so they were together on that brushback pitch. On the outside corner, it's 1-1. I don't think there's a thing in the world wrong with a pitch like that. That's how a pitcher makes his living. It's when you throw behind him that it gets.
Or when you throw at the head. That was letter high in off the plate. And actually, Gann has moved a little closer to the plate, but it was probably only 6 or 7 inches inside.
The 1-1. Swung and missed. So Belcher quickly out in front. So Gant will spread out even wider in the batter's box. A smoggy or foggy night in Los Angeles.
If you're a resident, it's foggy. If you're not, it's smoggy.
The 1-2 pitch. It fouled on the right side. You can see him just swing almost entirely with his upper torso that time. His legs were frozen in that batter's box, but he's strong enough to do a lot of damage that way.
And successful pitchers know how to make adjustments, even to a scouting report. Scouting report on Gant, he's a first ball fastball hitter. Starts him off with a breaking ball first time up, he hammers it. Now here's an adjustment by a pitcher and a catcher right in the middle of a game. He's seen four fastballs now this at bat.
The 1-2, here we go. Lined into left field, Daniels goes back, he's there, and the inning is over. Gant hit the devil out of the ball, but Cal Daniels made the play easily. So the Braves had a chance, but could not score. One hit, no runs. There were no errors. There was a pass ball, a couple men left. We go to the bottom half of the third inning in Dodger Stadium. Capacity crowd looking on. Braves won. Dodgers won. We go to the bottom half of the third inning. Top of the order up. You see part of the big mob here in Dodger Stadium. Butler, Samwell, and Strawberry will be the first three. We told you our first trip in here about the problems they'd had by turning the concessions over to various fast food outlets. Dodger dogs were being cooked differently, and the peanuts were different, and the fans were up in arms. Well, everything sort of got quieted down, and then it came out in the paper that the people who run the new concessionaire said that the workers should continue working during the national anthem to service the fans who were in line, and now everybody's upset about that. It's been a tough first year for the new concessionaire.
Old traditions and old habits die hard.
And sometimes shouldn't die at all.
I'll buy that.
Butler singled to left his first time. Sanders is camped on the line. Breaking ball strike over the inside corner, 0-1.
Brett wants to send along a happy birthday to Lowry Robinson back in Atlanta and promises you he'll have a very expensive gift for you for your birthday, since he is wishing you happy birthday over television.
That's how they can afford it. Ball.
Breaking ball downstairs. Good little guy.
1-1 is the count. Here's an interesting stat for you out of the Dodger notes. Brett Butler has flied to right field only once all year. That was against Tom Glavin on April 23rd.
I've been trying to find that somewhere for the last 2 days.
Glad I could help. Run up to bunt, took a strike, and he had a good pitch to bunt. A off-speed breaking ball, 1-2. Butler also, in 301 at bats this year, has yet to ground into a double play. And he's not, by no means, is he the fastest man in the league. But he handles the bat about as well as anybody. He just stayed alive, had a funny looking swing at that point.
And if you watch him, he very seldom hits the ball directly at an infielder. That's another reason. And the Braves have a defensive alignment against him in the infield you won't see too often. They're inviting him to hit the ball up the middle. They're taking the hole away over there by shortstop. And just now, Lemke moved a little closer to second.
With another shot at left field, fouled it away.
I've only seen that defensive alignment one or two other times. The last time I can remember, it was against Wade Boggs, who almost always would shoot it through that hole. He liked Butler, a good two-strike hitter. And then he would try to pull it in the right.
The 1-2 gets away from Olsen. Even now, two balls, two strikes. Nobody on, nobody out. Bottom of the third. Sam Well is next. High chop toward first. Bell has it. One away. Sam Well, a strikeout victim his first time.
Number
high fastball.
One, Sam Well.
So Juan stands in there, and Darryl Strawberry moves on deck. Outside with a change. One ball, no strikes. Just think of that. Connie Mack, 7,679 games. Ground ball sharply hit, but right at Blounder. Hop, skip, and throw. Bell stayed on, two down.
Well, he didn't even have to wear a uniform either, did he?
Number 44.
No, well, when you manage and own the team, well, come to think of it, Ted had to wear a uniform. Turner managed 7,678 games less than Connie Mack.
But all the pictures you've ever seen of Connie Mack, he's sitting very dignified in his suit with a hat on.
But he was a player first, then a player manager, then a player owner, then a manager owner. Curve strike.
Not a lot is different. There's still players to try to manage, and some don't have the ball.
Many of them sit up here with me. The pitch is inside, a ball and a strike. Every time a player comes up here, Bob Horner used to do it when he was hurt, had a broken thumb. Mark Grant the other night in Atlanta. There's been various other guys down through the years. They all say the same thing. It looks so easy from up here.
It is easy from up here.
Sure it is. 2-1. Fouled off at home plate. Two balls, two strikes. Eddie Murray would be next. They're two out in the inning. It's a 1-1 game. Dodgers have four hits. Braves have three. Just missed. Glavin thought he had it. 3-2 the count. Strawberry singled the left his first time. Fastball, strike three called, outside corner at the knees, inning over. He challenged him and lived to tell the story. That's four strikeouts for Tom Glavin. We have completed three innings here, and the game is tied 1-1. Quickly, National League scoreboard. Doc Gooden beat Philadelphia 3-1. John Franco is 18th. Save Howard Johnson, two more RBIs. He now has 63. Montreal ended an 11-game losing streak. Dennis Martinez beat John Smiley. Cubs are winning. Cincinnati beat Houston. Hammond got the win. San Diego over San Francisco. And here's Don Sutton.
And there's Jeff Blauser taking strike one from Tim Belcher. Blauser is 0 for 1. Fly to center, his only other at bat. That's low. It's 1-1. Belcher, fastball, slider, has worked on an off-speed pitch. Uses the split finger somewhat. There's the breaking ball. There's Griffin. To Murray, and Bowser's gone. One out, Mike Bell's the batter. Alfredo Griffin, who,
number 11,
for the past couple Mike of years,
Bell.
There have been obituary columns drawn up for his playing career, but he keeps managing to be out there and to make the plays. Griffin, a part of a starting nine here for the Dodgers, none of whom grew up in the Dodger organization. All the way by Bell, it's 0-1. Daniel started in Cincinnati, Butler in Atlanta, Strawberry in New York, Sharperson at Toronto, Murray with Baltimore, Samwell with Philadelphia, Carter with the Mets, Belcher with the Yankees, and Griffin started with Cleveland. Can't hold up on the high fastball. It's 0-2 to Bell. Like a lot of ball clubs, the philosophy of the Dodgers have changed over the last few years. It used to be when you looked at a roster, you could see 15, 20 players who were homegrown. That's outside, 1-2. Greg Olson waits on deck. Strikeout number four for Tim Belcher.
Here it is again.
Number 10.
Right on the outside edge.
Olsen.
Belcher's trip to the Dodgers. Here's Olsen. Was an interesting one. He was originally signed by the Yankees, but before he ever got to play there, Oakland took him after they had lost a free agent. One of those times in the free agent ruling where you could claim a player from somebody else if you lost one. And Belcher had just been signed by the Yankees for a very short time. Oakland immediately picked him. He struggled in their minor league system until he came down here as a player to be named later for Rick Honeycutt. Foul away. 0-2 to Olsen.
Yankees are a team that, down through the years with all the wheeling and dealing they've done in the last decade, if you looked it up, you could make virtually an all-star lineup out of people they gave up on. Either in a trade or a minor league deal or let get drafted.
Guys, 1-2.
Guys like Willie McGee, for example.
Seem to be trying to change that trend this year. They're attracting a good deal of interest the way they're playing, much better this year. Most of it is coming with homegrown young talent. Olsen stays alive. It's still 1-2.
And you never know how much, if anything, it has to do with it, but things are a lot quieter up there. Mr. Steinbrenner is not totally out of the loop, but he's out of the loop as far as the commissioner can get him, and he hasn't had a lot to say. Maybe that's been an item, maybe it hasn't.
Just outside with the breaking ball, it's 2-2 to Olsen. Well, their general manager is a quiet, very knowledgeable baseball man, that being Gene Michael, and I think that was a wise move to give stability to the Yankees, because that's one thing that Michael really likes that.
on the ground towards short. Griffin again. Murray again. That'll take care of Olsen. Braves go 1-2-3 here in the fourth inning. Belcher sets them down in order. We have played 3.5 at Dodger Stadium, and we're still tied at 1.
Well, we just bragged on the Yankees, so naturally their six-game losing streak, our winning streak, came to an end tonight. Baltimore beat them. Milwaukee over Cleveland. The Red Sox hammered Detroit. Kevin Morton got the win. White Sox beat Minnesota. Texas, Jose Guzman, three-hitter against California. Oakland is winning big at Kansas City. No score in Seattle.
Here it's 1-1. Braves got on the board in the first inning. Pendleton single with the second on an error.
Number 33.
Tripled him home.
Eddie.
Dodgers got a leadoff single from Cal Daniels in the second. Mike Shopperson doubled him home. That's how he's doing. Four hits for the Dodgers. All have gone the opposite field off Tom Glavine. Butler single to left. Daniels single to left. Sharperson triple to right. And Strawberry went the other way in the first inning for a base hit. Here's Eddie Murray. Breaking ball is there. Strike one. Very quietly, Eddie Murray has done this. And that's right at 100 a year. That's pretty impressive production. That's outside. It's 1-1. One ball, one strike. Right on by him. It's 1-2. Glavin with that good four-seam fastball. When you talk to Tom Glavin, I think you'll get the opinion from him that he's had that all along, but was encouraged to pitch with that down and away two-seam fastball. Murphy fights that off, stays alive. And the changeup, and as the breaking ball has just developed in the last couple of years, but one of the things you find when you watch young pitchers develop is that power is a gift and control is something that they work at to acquire, and he has blended both of those. You remember back to spring training, Tom Glavine struggled a little with his control because he was having big trouble setting the sights on that four-seam fastball. There's a changeup, and it's a dandy. That'll take care of Murray. Five strikeouts for Tom Glavine.
I don't know if anybody keeps charts of this, but I'll bet in the last
number
3 years he's struck out more guys with his change than
Daniels.
He has with his fastball. It has really been a terrific strikeout pitch for him.
Well, you've seen him a lot more than I. Did he always have the good motion on it when he first started?
Pretty good motion, but it, 3 years ago, two years ago he could throw it for strikes. Last year, as you know, he had trouble throwing it for strikes. This year again, those 2 years he struck out more guys, I think, than last year.
Here's a tough out for him, Cal Daniels. Did he fiddle with a change in the grip last year?
Not that I know of. We'll have to ask him.
Maybe just a difference in the motion of his arm. Well, he's got a dandy. He's got Cal Daniels 1-0. One hopper, Blauser. To Mike Bell. Got to take care of Daniels very quickly. Two out in the fourth inning.
Number 8. Gary.
And here's Gary Carter.
Carter
with a 12-game hitting streak on the line. Mike Socia's bad fortune, getting the hand hurt, has become Gary Carter's good fortune. A couple of years ago was asking around looking for a job. Got to play with the Giants last year. They didn't invite him back.
He's looking for a job again.
And here he ends up with the Dodgers.
Well, he's been a terrific pickup.
Off the fist. The hitting streak is alive. That's 13 in a row for Gary Carter. Only Brett Butler's 19-game hitting streak is longer than that of Gary Carter's.
Sharperson.
Two-out single. He's at first. Here's Mike Sharperson. He's driven home the only Dodger run. Took a high fastball over Mike Bell's head down in the right field corner. Sharperson, acquired from Toronto a couple of years ago for a young pitching prospect named Jose Guzman. Takes the breaking ball high. It's 1-0. He'll play you any position you want him in the infield, and if you get desperate, he'll grab a glove and head to the outfield. On the ground, Pendleton will have to hurry. Does get him. That'll take care of Sharperson. That'll do it for the Dodgers in the fourth. They get a runner on a base hit, but he is left stranded. We've completed four at Dodger Stadium. We'll have ourselves a 1-1 tie. One-one tie. Belcher, Glavin locked in a good one. You might have expected that coming into the game. Both of them right near the top of the league in earned run average. Braves with one in the first. Dodgers one in the second. He is not planning on building something to destroy someone. That's a weight that a lot of hitters use to loosen up with. That was Lenny Harris over in the Dodger dugout before.
There's the wave here, Don.
Yeah, it is, and I'm still not doing it.
That makes sense out here, so close to the ocean.
Here's Mark Lemke. Takes it upstairs. It's 1-0. A lot bigger wave than we've seen before. Here we go. You ready? Ball two is low. Everybody's entitled to one happy childhood, and I think you and I are having ours. That's high. It's 3-0 to Lemke. Neither Belcher nor Glavin has issued a base on ball.
Actually, I hate the wave as much as you do, but I got so much mail from people who got mad at me because I hated it
and gave in to the pressure.
No, I thought I'd give the people who
hate it
another way now a chance to write me.
That's ball four. Lemke's on board. First walk of the night by Belcher. And here's Tom Glavin. He, in all likelihood, will be expected to sacrifice Lemke to second. So how's the mail coming?
Yeah, well, I haven't been doing it long enough, really, to get gauge. I'll let you know when we get home.
Jimmy Williams flashed the signs down to Tom Glavin. Dodgers looking for bunt. Sharperson in a couple of steps at third base. He will move in closer as Belcher sets the pitch. Griffin, Samuel, both shortening up a little bit. He is bunting. He's taking strike one. Glavin's batting average, now that he has the base hit tonight, just a shade under 300. Most of that means nothing, but somewhere hidden in there is one that means something. And again, it's 1-1. A run and three hits for the Braves. Dodgers a run and five hits. Dodgers have committed an error. Lemke at first. He drew the leadoff base on ball.
I think the sign should be the third base person yells in bunt.
Especially
and that either means bunt or don't bunt.
So what do you do with inflection?
Oh, you know in advance which
one it means. Sharperson is creeping in.
However, that might not work with guys who have a sort of short attention span.
I've seen that happen right here in this park. 1-1 to Glavin. Here comes Sharperson. He's swinging. Fouls it away. It's 1-2. Played with a guy here. Third base coach was Danny Ozark. And it was a guy who should remain nameless. Got the sign, missed it. Got the sign, missed it. Finally, Ozark called him down to third base and talked to him about it and said, this is what I want you to do. Goes back to home plate, swings away. He said, you were supposed to bunt. How come you didn't? He said, I forgot. He has a short career.
I would think.
1-2 to Tom Glavin. Bunting again. This time it's a good one. Sharperson will have one play. That's to Murray, barely. Sacrifice works. Lemke's at second. So the go-ahead runs in scoring position.
Right fielder.
Sharperson takes it easy on this throw and almost throws it away. Murray goes about as high as he can go. Has to shift feet. And if he doesn't shift the feet, he misses the play.
I'll bet you there aren't many first basemen who can do that. That's years of playing that spot.
Not many guys do it anymore. It seems like back in the 50s and 60s, first basemen did that all the time.
I remember a guy named Vic Power. Oh, boy. Who could pick it at first with a flare. He was years ahead of his time. Foul away by Nixon. It's 0-1. Nixon now hitting .322. If he played now, he'd have his own line of clothes and jewelry. Because he had the flair. Pretty good hitter, too.
Yeah, it used to be called showboating. Now it's accepted behavior.
Now it's called style.
Or merchandising, one of the two.
Lemke is at second, one gone. Nixon lays off the high one. It's 1-1. Nixon is struck out. He laid down a sacrifice bunt back in the third inning, 0-1. You see Carter giving the combination of signs. Did he hold up? They'll ask. No swings. Said Bill Hahn down at third. It's 2-1 to Nixon.
You can tell it's a hot night here in Los Angeles. Very muggy, Atlanta-like weather.
Belcher and Carter getting their work in. Belcher's really been pitching well, earned run average-wise. Got some wins, but not as many as his pitching has dictated. That's fouled away down the left field line. Daniels won't be able to get through it. 2-2 to Nixon. I bet Daniels is one of those guys that has to pack those knees in ice afterwards because he has had a bunch of surgery on it.
It's a shame. You see guys like he and Gary Templeton and remember what they were like when they first came up, when those knees were unmarred.
Throw the name of Andre Dawson into that collection of people. Good split finger from Belcher. That'll take care of Nixon. Strikeout number 5 for Belcher.
The bottom of the outside on this one, you can see Otis going way over.
So Belcher one out away from pitching out of the one out walk or the leadoff walk he gave to Lemke. He'll have to get out Deion Sanders. He is 0 for 2, but he reached base back in the third inning when Gary Carter couldn't handle the strikeout pitch, and Deion took off and made it easily to first. Lemke at second, two gone. That's low, it's 1-0. Skip Caray, Don Sutton, Pete Van Weert will be joining you. One more out, take you the rest of the way. Sanders. That's there. It's 1-1. Dodgers with Belcher. Skip pointed out on a couple of hitters earlier, they don't really expect anybody in this Braves lineup to pull him except maybe Gant. They shade their outfielders the other way. The infielders all cheat a couple of steps to the off-field. And even more pronounced with Deion Sanders, who takes it low, 2-1. You see Daniels in left over to the line. Butler, who almost always plays shallow, very shallow in left center field. That right center field alley. That's headed to left center field, but Daniels is able to close the distance, calls it in, and that'll do it for Sanders. That'll do it for the Braves. The leadoff walk comes to nothing. We have played 4.5 in Los Angeles. We still have ourselves a 1-1 tie.
There There's the story of our game as we go to the bottom of the fifth. Don't forget, tomorrow night we'll be with you at 10 o'clock Eastern time, 4 o'clock Eastern on Sunday against the Dodgers. Prior to the All-Star break, that fellow will participate, may be the starting pitcher, in fact. We go to the bottom half of the fifth inning, and with the play-by-play story, here's Pete Van Rier.
Okay, thank you, Skip. Alfredo Griffin will lead things off for the Dodgers. He drove in their run with a sac fly to right. Back in the second, he'll be followed by the pitcher, Tim Belcher, then back to the top of the order, Brett Butler.
Number seven, Alfredo Griffin.
Griffin, who was all but written off over the wintertime as the Dodgers' shortstop this year. They thought he'd lose his job to Jose Offerman, but he didn't. In fact, lately, he's played quite well. Blavin's first pitch to Griffin, little one-hopper to third. Easy play for Terry Finlan. One pitch, one out in the bottom half of the fifth. And now the pitcher, Tim Belcher, was a strikeout victim. His first time up.
Number 49, Tim Belcher.
Cincinnati has already won its game tonight, so they're trying to climb to within three of the Dodgers. The Braves have to beat the Dodgers for that to happen. Nothing won the count, and Belcher, who, like Glavin, helps himself with the bat on occasion. Has a 171 average as he stands in here in the fifth inning. Glavin quickly out in front, nothing and two. He's gone on three pitches. That's a half dozen strikeouts for Tom Glavin, who is on that double-figure strikeout pace again. Belcher didn't care for the third call by Terry Tata.
Center fielder, Brad Butler.
And a couple of parting words for him. Now Brett Butler, who didn't waste time getting his hitting streak extended to 19 games, hit the first pitch he saw in the first inning in the left field. In the third, he grounded out to first. Outside, ball one. Glavin's control again tonight has been excellent. No walks. There's a strike in the inside corner. One ball, one strike. Misses 2-1, the count on Butler. Two men out, bases empty. We're in the bottom half of the fifth inning, tied at one. The Dodgers winners of five of their last six, the Braves losers of five of their last six, and the pitchers battle tonight between Belcher and Glavin. Deep short, nice play to his left by Blauser, throwing on to first in time to get Butler, and it's a 1-2-3 inning for Tommy Glavin. Nothing doing for the Dodgers in the fifth. And after five, we're still tied, 1-1. Top half of the sixth inning, and Terry Penland leads it off in a 1-1 game. He has a hit and two at bats. Drills this one deep to right field. Strawberry going back, looking up. It's going to be off the wall. Penland, after a long turn at first, will be held to a 370-foot single. As Strawberry played the carom perfectly. Terry now 2-for-3.
I think Strawberry got a little break here. I think the ball short hopped the wall and then kicked right back to him. Yeah, it did. Came right back to him knee high. He's got a great arm, and he showed it there. And Terry would have been a dead duck if he'd have tried it.
That is hit number four off of Tim Belcher. It'll bring up Ronnie Gadd, who tripled in a run in the first inning and hit one deep to left field, caught by Daniels in the third. One popped up foul territory, but too deep for Gary Carter to get to.
The count nothing and one on Ronnie Gant, who continues that unusual statistic. He has more extra base hits than he does singles this year. He's got 61 hits on the year, 17 doubles, 2 triples, 15 home runs, 34 extra base hits out of his 61 hits. Nothing and one, the count on Ronnie Gant. Nobody out, top of the sixth, tied at one. Driven deep, but foul down the left side. Well, he got into that one. But Belcher ahead on the count now, nothing and two. Belcher now ready for the 0-2 to Ron Gant. Carter blocked it. One ball, two strikes. Gary Carter finding the fountain of youth this year. He is having one of his best stretches of games right now that he's had in half a dozen years. Offensively and defensively. Two on the way. Gant started after it, held up and missed low and away. Two and two the count. The 2-2 offering to Gant just got a piece of it and wedges in the screen behind home plate. It remains two balls, two strikes. Tantalizing for that youngster back there. He can't quite reach it. There it is. The kid in the red cap is the kid that watched the ball.
He's thinking about climbing up that baby.
All sorts of things going through his mind now. How can I get that ball? Another 2-2 hit right back where it came from. Belcher knocks it down, has a play down at second. That's the only out they get. That's a good play by Belcher. He got the glove down, knocking it down, was able to get the force play on Terry Pendleton down at second. Ronnie Gant becomes the runner at first.
Gant has hit that baby on the nose every time tonight. He's only 1-for-3, and he almost pulled him off there, but Sam Wells stayed on just long enough.
That'll bring up Jeff Blauser, who has flied to center and grounded out to short. Braves got their run in the first inning after two were out. Terry Pendleton reached in an infield hit and a throwing error. Scored on Ronnie Gant's triple. The Dodgers got the run right back in the bottom half of the second. A base hit by Cal Daniels. A double by Mike Sharperson sending him to third. And Alfredo Griffin's sack fly bringing the run in. Gant, 14 steals and 19 tries this year. He's on course for another 30-30 season. He has 15 homers, 14 stolen bases. We're not quite at the midway point of the season yet. Belcher again steps off and looks the runner back.
We were talking about Blauser before. Don and I agree, Beach, if you do, it's almost time that the Braves make up their mind about this guy. Either find a place for him to play every day or go ahead and make the move and get help for some other position.
Tell you what's impressed me the most about him this year, yes, his hitting has improved, and that's a big plus in his favor. But the fact that he's had to play second, short, and third on almost a rotating basis, and his defense has improved as well. There goes the runner. There's the throw by Carter. Didn't get him. Gant now 15 steals to go along with his 15 homers.
Don't blame Carter here. He made a heck of a throw. Ronnie got a good jump. A little bit to the third base side, and that allowed him to get in there, but you can't ask for a much better throw than that.
So Gant gets himself into scoring position. The count 1-0 on Jeff Blauser, continuing that thought about his defense. He used to struggle when he played one day at short, one day at second, particularly with his throws, but he's much improved both with his range and his throwing from all three spots this year, and he's been moved around so frequently. And it's very impressive to see him maintain that kind of consistency defensively and also improve his offense.
Yeah, a year ago you figured if he was going to be an everyday player, it was going to be in the American League as a designated hitter, but that's no longer the case.
Jeff with 8 hits in his last 15 at-bats, now at 280 for the year. Gant at second, one down. Driven high and deep to left field. Daniels going back to the track, looking up. It is gone. 2-run homer, Jeff Blauser. Braves lead it 3-1. Home run number 7, RBIs number 35 and 36 for Jeff Blauser.
He hits something off speed, either a split finger or a breaking ball. And he hit the daylights. That's only 5 home runs off Belcher this year. In about 108 innings. Yeah, he hung something belt high and he crushed it.
So Blauser puts the Braves on top by a couple. Now Mike Bell, who has flied to center and struck out. Blauser's going to have a career best RBI season this year. And it's going to happen fairly soon as Bell takes strike one. His best RBI year, 46 in 1989. He's got 36 already. 0-2 the count on Mike Bell.
He's got a shot at 80 RBIs and he doesn't play every
day. He's not a starter. The 0-2 to Bell, punch foul down the left side. Three runs, 5 hits now for Atlanta. 1-5-1 for the Dodgers. We're in the top of the 6th. That misses inside, 1-2. I heard 4 different members of the Braves say today at various times during the day that we have got to win 2 out of 3 in this series because you've got to go to the All-Star break over 500 after the first half that we have had. It'd be very disappointing to fall under 500 by the All-Star break after being over it for much of the first half of the season. That was the 5th strikeout of the game for Belcher, one down. There's one of the men that said it right there, Jim Beecham, saying it could be a key to the whole season. To do that, the Braves have to win 2 out of 3 in this series. Here's Greg Olson, who has struck out and grounded out. Over Griffin's head into left field, base hit. So it's beginning to unravel a little bit on Tim Belcher here in the 6th inning.
Mark, lefty.
No activity yet in the Dodger bullpen, but that may be about to change. Mark Lemke will be the hitter. He has flied out and walked. Second, fielded by Samwell. On to Murray in time. And that'll do it for the Braves in the 6th, but Atlanta takes the lead on the 2-run homer by Jeff Blauser. And we go to the bottom half of the 6th inning, 3-1 Atlanta.
Couple more here, then 3 days off for the All-Star break. The Cardinals come to call at the ballpark starting Thursday, a 4-game series. Followed by the always popular Cubbies, and there are your numbers for tickets.
We move to the bottom half of the 6th inning. Samwell, Strawberry, and Murray New up against Tom Glavin, who's been given two runs to work with now. It's 3-1 Atlanta. And Glavin, who has been the most remarkably consistent starting pitcher you could possibly ask for this year, could very easily have a 15-1 record going into this game. Lost three games by scores of 1-0, 2-0, and 2-1. Had one no-decision game where he only gave up one run in eight innings. Really only one bad start all year for Glavin. And Juan Samuel will start it here in the sixth. He has struck out and grounded out to short. Samuel really benefiting from being in the number two spot in this Dodger order. He used to hit third a lot. But you hit second behind Brett Butler. All the times Butler's on base, you're going to get a lot of fastballs, and that's what Samuel's forte is, hitting fastballs.
I think it's helped him, too, that they're vulnerable to left-hand pitching, and he's a right-hand hitter. In fact, I think he's the key to their club this year. He's a 240 hitter last year. He's a 320 hitter this year with a lot of homers, a lot of RBIs.
42 runs driven in over two hole. That's excellent. One ball, one strike. Didn't get the changeup. He has not seen a fastball from Glavin. It's 1-2. Going to go into his third All-Star game.
You could have had him for a ham sandwich during the offseason.
Glavin ahead in the count, a ball and two strikes. He started to go. That's the kind of fastball you want to throw to Juan Samuel, one up around the eyes, because many times he'll chase that pitch. Still strikes out a lot. He'll always do that. 2-2 the count. And there is that high fastball. For Tom Glavin, now seven strikeouts in the ballgame.
Right fielder.
Probably out of the strike zone. Oh, today's strike zone, but Samuel can't lay off.
Glavin is now tied for the National League strikeout lead with David Cohn. They each have 105. Darryl Strawberry, the batter, he has singled and struck out. Foul back on one.
I have to laugh now, Pete. Remember when Glavin first came up and you and Ernie and I'd go to dinner trying to figure out our ball club, and we worried about him because he never struck anybody out?
That certainly has changed. A couple more miles an hour on the fastball, a more effective mix, the changeup more effective. There's a bouncing ball out to second, handled by Lemke. Two down quickly here in the bottom half of the sixth inning with the Braves leading at 3-1. Now the slumping Eddie Murray.
Murray.
0 for 19 now after hitting into a 5-4 three-double play his first time up tonight, striking out his next time up. All the controversy over Murray being selected ahead of Fred McGriff for the All-Star team. I can think of one reason why Lou Piniella and Bill White may have opted for Eddie Murray over McGriff. He's a switch hitter. He'll be coming in late in the ballgame in all likelihood. As a little pop-up, is going to be an easy inning for Tom Glavin. Eddie Murray's slump continues. Greg Olson puts that away. Murray's now 0 for his last 20. Dodgers go quietly in the bottom half of the sixth. After six complete, still 3-1 Atlanta. We move to the top half of the seventh inning. Pitcher Tom Glavin will be leading it off for Atlanta, along with Otis Nixon and Deion Sanders. Glavin tonight has bunted twice, once for a base hit in the third, a sacrifice bunt in the fifth. Five bunts tonight for Atlanta. Two sacrifices, one went for a base hit. Otis Nixon bunted strike two foul. Deion Sanders, trying to bunt his way on, was thrown out. Ball one high to Glavin, who's now hitting 297. That's going to be his only regret at this year's All-Star game. They're using the DH. He won't get the hit. Back, it's one ball, one strike.
I'm sure he'll get over that.
He was out shopping for some All-Star duds today. Passed him walking downtown with a couple of bags of clothing. 1-1 the count. down the left field line, well hit but foul. And Belcher ahead in the count, 1-2. Braves up 3-1. F. Blauser's two-run homer in the sixth, breaking the 1-1 deadlock. Now the 1-2. Got him inside corner. Belcher records strikeout number 7. One away, top of the seventh. Back to the top of the order now, Otis Nixon, who struck out twice tonight and also had a sacrifice. Good crowd, Otis, close to a sellout, 49,199. The Dodgers, a little over $1.6 million now for the year, as they head for another potential $3 million season. And as long as they keep playing like they are, they're assured of it. Nixon trying to bunt his way out here, files it back on one. Base is empty. We're in the top half of the seventh. Here's the pitch on the way to Otis, taken high and outside. A fastball missing. One ball, one strike. Belcher's 1-1 pitch. In the dirt for a ball. 2-1. Story in today's Los Angeles papers about how upset Mike Morgan was not getting selected to go to the All-Star game with a 9-5 record and 2.48 earned run average. Belcher could say he belongs. He is 7-4 with a 2.22 earned run average. There's Morgan. This whole Dodger rotation has been excellent this year. Full count 3-2 now on Otis Nixon. The entire pitching staff of the Dodgers has an earned run average under 3, 2.92. Now look at those numbers. Everybody pitching better this year than they did last. Here's the 3-2 pitch to Otis, fouled away. Still 3-2.
Ojeda must be close to a complex. 3.12 and you're fourth among the starters.
Their vulnerable point right now is the bullpen, with Jay Howell out of action due to an ailing elbow. The few losses the Dodgers have suffered the last couple of weeks, most of them have been because the bullpen has not performed. Pop foul again, out of play by Nixon, still 3-2. There's a soft line drive, shallow left field, coming hard. The left fielder, Cal Daniels, can't come up with it. Nixon's going to head for second, and he'll go in easily. Daniels almost got to that ball, but was just able to get the webbing of his glove on it. And Otis, with his excellent speed, able to get all the way down to second.
5 years ago, he makes that play easily with his running speed, but the knee problems have really slowed him up. Then he kicked it away, and that gave Otis an extra base and gives the Braves a chance for some insurance.
One thing you will not see Cal Daniels do because of those knee problems is dive for a ball. And that's okay with his manager, Tom Lasorda. They don't want him re-injuring either one of those knees. Here's Deion Sanders. Sanders tonight, 0-3. Otis Nixon down at second with a double. And Deion takes a fastball upstairs, ball one. For Nixon, his seventh double of the year. He's the exact opposite of Ronnie Gant. Very few extra base hits for Otis. Most of his base hits, those little bouncing singles up the middle, are bunt base hits. Two and nothing. The count now on Deion Sanders. Here's the 2-0 on the way, and a good cut, fouled it back. Two balls and a strike on Sanders. Dion really two different kinds of hitters when he's up there. They've worked with him a lot, hitting the ball up the middle into the opposite field. But he still tries to pull inside pitches, because he does have some power when he gets a pitch in there. But it gives him, in effect, two different swings, which may not be a very good idea at this stage of his career. Mike Hartley now up in the Dodger bullpen. First activity they've had all night. Braves bullpen has had the night off so far, as they normally do when Tom Glavine pitches. Here's the 2-1. Tried to go the opposite way with that one. Fouled it off, 2-2. Dion must love coming to this city. About three blocks away, there's a whole street with nothing but jewelry stores.
Yeah, we're right in the middle of the jewelry district here.
Here's the 2-2. Another full count. Belcher laboring a little more the last couple of innings than he was over the first five.
If you're headed for that jewelry store area, though, you have to make sure you turn the right way out of the hotel. You go three blocks the other way is where the Skid Row slasher used to do his work.
Full count on Deion Sanders with one out, Nixon down at second. He goes through with a pitch, even though the shortstop Alfredo Griffin had cut over to the bag at second. Now Alfredo comes in to say, hey, if I'm over there, don't pitch. That leaves the whole left side of the infield wide open. Still a 3-2 count. And again, the payoff. Nixon is going. The pitch is low. Ball four. Safe at third. Otis Nixon with his 41st stolen base of the year. Just one away from tying Gerald Perry's club mark.
Perry.
And it's not even the All-Star break yet. Walk number two issued by Belcher. Stolen base number 41 for Otis Nixon. Runners at the corners now. Terry Pendleton, the batter. Pendleton tonight, 2-for-3. Pair of singles. He's also grounded out. And all kinds of possibilities here with Sanders at first and Nixon at third. Two of the fastest men in the league on at the corners with one down.
He almost got so fancy there, the Braves scored a run.
There's a new balk rule this year. If Murray is breaking in toward the plate, and Belcher is committed to throwing to first and throws to Murray, but he's not in a position to make an attempted tag on the runner at first, they can call a balk on Belcher. There's the bluff throw to third, the look toward first.
Looked like Otis was trying to draw a throw at third base.
He broke from the bag right after Belcher looked that way. You wouldn't want to beat Tim Belcher in this situation, but those two guys are bored. If Sanders breaks for the bag at second, you might see Belcher cut off the throw back by Carter. There's a bunt foul down the third base side by Pendleton, 0-1. Because you can be sure that if Sanders breaks for second and the throw goes through to second base, Otis Nixon's going to take off for home. And wouldn't that be some way to tie the Braves' single-season stolen base record? Still only one out in the inning. Little chopper hit slowly out toward second. Samwell flips to the shortstop for one. The run scores. It's 4-1 Atlanta. Not a double play ball. Fancy Dan play there on the force out. Little glove flip by Juan Samwell over to Alfredo Griffin. Give Pendleton an RBI, his 34th.
Boy, and I'm glad Deion slammed on the brakes there, because the only way they could have gotten a double play is if Samwell had been able to tag Sanders. But he slams on the brakes right there. to make sure they can't get that double play and gets his team another run.
That's what Bobby Cox was talking about all during spring training and throughout the earlier part of the year, the good instincts of Deion Sanders on the bases, in the outfield. Does a lot of the right things just instinctively. Ronnie Gant, the batter, taking ball one low. Ronnie 1-for-3, a run scoring triple. He has stolen a base and scored a run tonight. 4-1 Atlanta. Braves with a chance to beat a nemesis, Tim Belcher, who's only lost one time in six decisions to Atlanta. Here's the 1-0. Gant didn't get the breaking ball. One ball, one strike on Ronnie Gant. Left-hander Dennis Cook joins Mike Hartley in the Dodger bullpen. Over the first five innings, gave up only a run on three hits. In these last two innings, he's given up three runs, four hits, had a lot of deep counts. So it's been the third, now the fourth time around the order that Belcher has begun to wear down a little bit tonight. There's the runner at first, Terry Pendleton, Eddie Murray holding him. A count of one ball, two strikes on Ronnie Gant. Bad throw to first base. Pendleton takes off. He might make it all the way around to third. He'll hold up there as the throw finally comes home. You've heard about all the foul territory here at Dodger Stadium. Well, that's what happens when a throw to first base goes awry. That ball rolls for a long time before anybody can get to it.
Here's another look. The throw really wasn't that bad, was it? See how they score. It was into the runner, and that's what discombobulated Eddie Murray.
There'll be an error charge. We'll see who it's charged to, though, Belcher or Murray. A runner at third now with two outs and a 1-2 count on Gant. Little chopper down the third base side. It is going to roll foul. They are charging the error to Belcher on that pickoff play. Still 1-2 on Ronnie Gant. Pretty good lip on the grass here along the foul line. Back in the third inning, I was really surprised when Tom Glavine got that bunt down that Mike Sharperson didn't let that one roll, because it was headed toward that lip, and if it hits that lip, you can see how close the grass is to the line. If it hits that lip, it's going to roll foul. There you see it. Good shot there. Again, the 1-2 to Ronnie Gant, little pop-up. And all that foul territory is going to pay off for the Dodgers this time, as Gary Carter has room to make the catch. A lot of ballparks, that would have been in the box seats. Here at Dodger Stadium, it's out number three. Seventh inning stretch time at Dodger Stadium, but it's the Braves leading it right now, 4-1. Bottom half of the seventh inning coming up. A big crowd here at Dodger Stadium. They're most of them sticking around. In fact, most of the crowd's staying a little later tonight than they normally do here at Dodger Stadium.
Fireworks after the game.
You normally have a big line of traffic streaming out of here by now.
Sutton's got a car. You want to try to beat the rush?
I think we should. Even the Braves are going to try to beat the rush. The normal time after the game for a bus to leave to go back to the hotel is about 45 to 50 minutes after game time. After the game ends, rather. Tonight they're going to try it in 25 minutes. And Cal Daniels will lead off here in the bottom half of the seventh. Tom Glavine enjoys a three-run lead now. Daniels tonight is singled and grounded out to short. There's a strike in the outside corner. We also can recall a day here at Dodger Stadium when they had fireworks during a severe drought. One of those hills out back caught on fire. High and deep to center field. Gatt going back toward the track. Slows down now on the track and makes the catch. That ball was hard hit by Daniels, who normally hits the ball hard somewhere just about every time up. That's eight in a row retired now by Glavine. The last man to reach was this man, Gary Carter, who extended his hitting streak to a career-high 13 games in a row with a fourth-inning single. He has also struck out. Ball one outside to Gary Carter. Bottom half of inning seven, 4-1 Atlanta. The win tonight by the Braves would mean the Dodgers' lead over Cincinnati goes down to three games. The Reds beat Houston tonight 1-0. The Braves will be back to within 7.5 games. Deion Sanders does the slam dunk with a beach ball. Speaking of races, they got one going in the American League West now. After today's results, Minnesota is still in first. California and Texas are each one game out. Chicago and Oakland are each 2.5 games out. Five teams within 2.5 games of the lead.
That's the way it's supposed to be. That's when it's fun.
Glavine's 1-0 pitch on the way down to Gary Carter almost hit him with a low inside fastball. Looked like Glavine landed funny there. Something was wrong with the front part of that mound, and that threw him off a bit.
He made him do a little dance.
There you can see him looking down at the landing spot. He's a little groundskeeping in that area after that pitch. 2-0 the count. Behind 3-0. Glavine has not walked anyone tonight. A remarkable walk to strikeout ratio for Glavine this year. He has 20 walks, 105 strikeouts. That one caught the corner, 3-1. Pitcher on the way, back up the middle. Gary Carter continues his hot streak. He is 2-for-3 tonight. And that's a half dozen hits now off Glavine. The batter will be Mike Sharperson.
That's 2,000 hits for Gary Carter in his career.
And you saw him signaling for that baseball. It'll be thrown out of play, and they put it up now on the screen out in left center field. Career hit number 2,000. That'll get a standing O from a crowd of just under 50,000. A future Hall of Famer right there. Very proud moment for him. Probably be a first-year inductee when he is eligible because he's been such a popular player with the media. And it's the writers who do the voting. Well, here's Sharperson. A ball and no strikes the count on the Dodger third baseman. Sharperson doubled in the second, grounded out to third in the fourth. Glavine threw in the center field base hit. Carter will stop down at second. And the Dodgers trying to get right back in it here. They have set the table for Alfredo Griffin. Runners first and second with one out. Hit number seven off Glavin, who almost gloved that one.
Shortstop.
And he's upset with himself that he didn't, even though it was hit so hard. You see Leo Mazzoni dialing up some help in the Atlanta bullpen. Let's look at it again here. A fastball just off the tip of his glove. Now Mazzoni has finished his phone call and comes to the mound.
One thing you see a lot of at Dodger Stadium, balls that hit in the dirt out in front of home plate. The dirt is very, very hard here at Dodger Stadium. And that ball just hit by Mike Sharperson, hit just shy where the grass cutout begins there. And the ball really takes off. Mike Stanton, the left-hander, Marvin Freeman, the right-hander, up in the Braves' pen. With Dodger runners at first and second, one out. And Alfredo Griffin, the batter, he had a sack fly on the second to drive in a run. He grounded out to third and the fifth, so he's 0 for 1. There are the runners. Sharperson at first, Carter at second. Changeup strike in the outside corner, 0-1.
That changeup seems like it's lost a little of that slide toward the outside part of the plate to a right-hand hitter.
Griffin hitting from the right side in particular, a double play. Possibility if he hits a ground ball. Chased a bad pitch. That's what you try to get him to do. Glavin ahead in the count 0-2. Belcher has come out to the on-deck circle, but I don't imagine he'll hit. One man out. Runners first and second. 4-1 Atlanta. Bottom half of the seventh. 0-2 pitch coming to Alfredo Griffin. Got a piece of it, stays alive. Gary Carter 2-for-3 tonight. He's down at second now. Mike Sharperson's 2-for-3 tonight. He's the runner at first. They have four, the Dodgers 7 hits. Again to Griffin, tried to get him to go fishing. He wouldn't chase it though. 1-2. Glavin's done his best pitching against the top part of this batting order. The four All-Stars are only 2-for-12 off Glavin tonight. Here's the 1-2 to Griffin. He chased a bad pitch low and inside. And Tom Glavin now leads the National League in strikeouts. That is strikeout number 106 on the season for Glavin.
This is a good pitch. He threw him a breaking ball down and in. He threw him that change that fades away from a right-hand hitter. And now he came in on him, and Griffin had no chance.
Now we get a pinch hitter for Tim Belcher. Stan Javier has a bat in the on-deck circle. And he'll come on to bat for Belcher with two outs, runners first and second here in the bottom of the seventh. Javier batting 236, a homer, 10 RBIs. Got quite a bit of playing time in the outfield when Darryl Strawberry was on the disabled list. Now he's back to his reserve role. He played well during that stretch when Strawberry was out. Hitting 321 for his last nine games. And in 10 games that he started in place of Strawberry, hit 351. Both of those pinch hits came while batting right-handed. He's 2-for-10 as a pinch hitter right-handed, 0-for-10 as a pinch hitter left-handed. Tim Cruz up now in the Dodger pen. Two men out, runners at first and second. We're in the bottom of the seventh. Braves leading at 4-1. Strike in the outside corner with a fastball. Glavin gets out in front quickly, nothing and one on Javier. Dodgers added another switch hitter to their bench when they acquired Mitch Webster in a trade for Jose Gonzalez of the Pittsburgh Pirates. The 0-1 missed outside, one ball, one strike. And that's a great asset when you have pinch hitters that are switch hitters, because it negates any move that a manager might make bringing someone in from the bullpen. You don't have to make two moves. Now the 1-1 to Javier. That's a foul ball. And the count 1-2. Bobby Cox not so sure about the foul ball call.
Greg Olson was trying to say that the ball hit him in fair territory, which of course would put him out.
Lavin ahead in the count, 1-2. Sharperson off first, Carter off second, two men out. And the 1-2 pitch on the way. Just missed the inside corner. Lavin gave it an extra look. 2-2. Look at the walks and strikeouts against the Dodgers for Tom Glavine this year. That's remarkable. Now the 2-2 on the way. Struck him out with a changeup. And Tommy Glavine shows you why he's the leading contender to start the All-Star game for the National League. He now leads the league in strikeouts. He's trying to lead the league in wins. And he is still leading 4-1 after 7. Before we begin the 8th inning, a look at our Delta scoreboard. The Mets beat the Phillies tonight 3-1. Howard Johnson drove in two more. He now leads the National League with 63 RBIs. It was Montreal ending an 11-game losing streak with a 4-3 win over Pittsburgh. Dennis Martinez won his 10th. Frank Castillo got his first Major League win as the Cubs beat the Cardinals 5-1. Cincinnati outpitched Houston tonight. Hammond and Dibble combining for a five-hitter. They beat Pete Harnish, who has now been involved in 6 1-0 games this year. San Diego leading San Francisco 4-2 there in the 8th inning. Over the American League, it was Baltimore over New York 7-4. That ends a 6-game Yankee winning streak. Milwaukee beat Cleveland 4-2. Boy, the Indians, they've lost 25 of their last 30 now. Boston 10-1 over Detroit. Kevin Morton won in his Major League debut. Chicago beat Minnesota 4-2. Texas shut out California 8-0. Oakland beat Kansas City 9-3. Toronto and Seattle tied at 1 there in the 7th. And for complete scores and highlights, tune in to CNN Sports Late Night, 11:30 Pacific Time. Vince Cellini and Bob Lorenz will have all the highlights for you. Here it's 4-1, Atlanta leading the Dodgers. We go to the 8th inning. Here's Skip.
Okay, Pete, thank you very much. Tim Cruz on to pitch for Los Angeles. You see him heating up there. And you see his numbers on the air. Braves lead by 3 and go for some insurance. Perhaps the biggest blow of the night came from the man who stands in there now, Jeff Blauser, a 2-run homer back in the 6th to give Atlanta a 3-1 lead. Blauser was 1 out of 18 against Tim Belcher when he hit that home run. So it's Blauser, Bell, and Olson scheduled in the Atlanta 8th inning. Here we go. Fastball fouled away. Into the second deck. It's nothing and one. Blauser, a California native, has friends and family here. Starter to go. It was in there anyway. That was a split finger. It's 0-2. Nobody on, nobody out. 8th inning. The outfield plays Blauser straight away. In fact, they give him the left field line. I don't think they'll pull the ball over the bag. Fastball away, right where Carter wanted it. 1-2 is the count. Blauser stands back in there, trying to get something started in the 8th inning.
Strike three called. Fastball outside corner. He knew it. So one away from Mike Bell, who's hit with some three at bats, has been out on strikes.
Good
a
sequence
of
pitches here by Cruz. He threw him that split finger, and that's what Blauser thought that pitch was going to be.
Bell,
but it didn't dip.
Day.
It stayed up at the knees on the corner.
Bell has flied to center, been called out on strikes, been out swinging. We'll be with you a half hour earlier tomorrow night. It's a 10 o'clock telecast. Down Smoltz against Oral Hershiser. Swung and missed, 0-1. Hershiser was not impressive at all in the game he pitched in Atlanta.
They're getting concerned about him. He got the win in that game, but that was a game the Dodgers got a lot of runs early. He lasted through five.
His sinker didn't seem to be sinking.
And not much life to his fastball.
Greg Olson waits on deck. One out here. Didn't get that one. He's in the hole 0-2.
Another thing the Dodgers have been concerned about with Hershiser, he's a control pitcher, and although he hasn't been walking a lot of people, he's been behind an awful lot of hitters. He's throwing a lot of 2-0 and 3-1 pitches, and those are hitters' pitches.
They shade Bell slightly toward left field. A lot of room in right center for him, but he's in the hole 0-2. Tap foul, pass first, count stays the same. $49,199 paid here tonight. Cincinnati won their game. They can move to within three if the Braves hang on. Lazy pop into left field. Daniels there near the line. Two down. Greg Olson is one for three.
Greg.
He is struck out, bounced out, and singled. If the Braves have a chance to get back into this thing, they've got to get some wins out of John Smoltz. So a big start for him tomorrow night. On the corner with that split finger again, 0-1.
Braves concerned about two spots in the rotation, Smoltz's spot and Pete Smith's spot. The other three are doing just fine.
Right through there, the fastball. Boy, he's sharp as a tack. 0-2. Olson out of the batter's box for just a moment. Now he stands back in. Low and away. Bounced off the chest protector of Gary Carter. Well, good to be working with Doug Freeman again. He's directing our telecast tonight. Glenn Diamond is our producer. The 1-2 pitch. Swung and bounced foul past third. Count stays 1-2. Carter looks a little tired behind the plate tonight. You can't blame him at
his age.
Yeah,
he's been doing yeoman duty back there, catching every game for the Dodgers the last 2 weeks.
And doing a terrific job. The 1-2 pitch. Strike three called. Fastball outside corner. Olson argues about it, but he's out and the inning is over. Nothing doing for Atlanta in the eighth. Cruz gets him 1-2-3. We go to the bottom half. 4-1 Atlanta. Inning, top of the order for the Dodgers. One defensive change for Atlanta. Rafael Belliard
for the Brave
checks in the game to play shortstop.
Number two, Rafael
Butler is one for three, and he'll lead it off. He's 8 out of 25 in his career against Tom Glavine, who's pitched another classic. He's allowed 7 hits. He's struck out 9, and he hasn't walked anybody. And the bottom of the eighth ready to get underway. No activity at the moment in the Atlanta bullpen. A lefty up and throwing for the Dodgers. Glavin goes to work. He takes it right through there, 0-1. With you at 10 o'clock tomorrow night, Smoltz and Hershiser. Tried to stop his swing, lined it back. Everybody okay down below. Those are the kind that can do some damage. 0-2 is the count. Butler, after all these years, finally an all-star. But you know, taking nothing away from him, he's had another fine year. You put his stats up against Otis Nixon's, you can argue for Otis. The 1-2, here it is. Foul back again. Count stays the same.
The two long hitting streaks have really helped Brett Butler. A 16-game streak earlier, now a 19-game streak currently in effect, and leads the league in runs scored, as he so often does. He's going to score over 100 runs again this year if he stays healthy.
Boy, would the last decade of Braves baseball have been different without the trades that sent him back. Little tap for short. Dugout gets an early chance. He's equal to it. One up.
Take nothing away from Belliard's overall play this year, but this may be his role for a while now, until the Braves start to get some of the bats back with Bream and David Justice. With Blauser hitting the ball the way he is, he may just get a chance to start a few games at shortstop, with Belliard coming in defensively late in the game.
Juan Samuel is 0 for 3 tonight, 10 out of 30 in his career against Glavin. Shortened to bunt, just a little low. One ball, no strikes. One thing that has been constant about Glavin throughout his career, though even that has improved as he's aged a bit, is his composure. He does not fluster out there. Tried to bunt his way on, bunted a foul, 1-1. Darryl Strawberry waits on deck.
But he did say this spring that he spent the offseason for the first time in his entire career wondering if he really had what it takes to be a big winner in the majors after his disappointing season last year, and said he really went to spring training this year determined that if he was going to be a big winner in the major leagues, it had to begin now.
I remember I kidded him after a win about 2 weeks ago. Why don't you give the rest of the league a break? He said, I did that all last year, Skip. Two balls, one strike. Challenged him with a fastball, 2-2. Let's see if he throws that high fastball one more time. One out, nobody aboard.
He was one of the first of the young pitchers I heard over the winter saying it's time to shed the label potential. We've heard that long enough about me.
The 2-2 pitch, here it is. Swung, a little tap. Can Pendleton get there? Yes. Good play, 2-2. I don't know if Belliard could have thrown him out. Pendleton was running right toward the play and took care of business. 2-2.
Strawberry. Right
and here's Strawberry. And this is the kind of spot you like to see him up there. Nobody on, two out. And his team down by three. Darryl is 1-for-3 tonight, and in his career, 2 out of 21 against Tom Glavin. The Braves shade him way around toward left and pitch him away. A breaking ball on the corner, nothing and one.
And the top four hitters in the Dodger order, all-stars this year, now a collective 2-for-14 off Tom Glavin.
Strawberry steps up. Pop fly on the infield. Glavin breezes through another inning and gets him 1-2-3. No hits, no runs, no errors, nobody left. We go to the ninth inning. Braves on top, 4-1. We go to the ninth inning. Dennis Cook on to pitch for the Dodgers. Cruz won a perfect inning and struck out two. And Mark Lemke will lead it off against him, and then Tom Glavine. There's the Dodger left-hander. Lemke leads it off. He's 0 for 2 with a walk. He's a switch hitter. He turns around and bats right.
25, Dennis Cook.
And coming into tonight, it didn't really matter. He was hitting 250 right-handed, 250 left-handed.
Mark Lemke, second base.
So Lemke leads it off in the ninth. Four-one Atlanta is our score. It's Tom Glavine night again.
Last time Dennis Cook fakes Mark Lemke, hit a line drive to shortstop that Alfredo Griffin swears he caught.
I swear he did too. A little bit inside, 2-0.
It was called a trap ball, and Lemke wound up getting an RBI out of it.
Murray, Daniels, and Carter do in the ninth for the Dodgers. So the Braves not out of the woods here yet. There's a strike over the outside corner, a fastball. It's 2-1. Dodgers play Lemke shallow and toward right. And he hits one hard to right field, but fouled on the right field line. Two balls, two strikes. Glavine waits on deck. He has a hit tonight, a bunt single. He's one out of two. The Reds beat Houston 1-0. They can move to within three. More importantly to us, we can move back to within 7.5. The best the Braves can do in this big 10-game stretch that has included 7 with the Dodgers and 3 with the Reds is 5-5 now, and they have to sweep this series to do that.
That would put them right back where they were when it all began, 5.5 out.
Except 10 more games down the chute. Just missed inside. But by the same token, it could be disastrous. Unless the Braves play well out here, and they certainly have so far tonight. That's to Griffin, off balance throw is high, and he's safe. We'll see how they score.
It's a hit. Base hit. That should be a base hit. Took a little more than a routine effort by Alfredo Griffin on this one. And that's what the scorer is supposed to consider when he rules whether it's a base hit or an error. That would have been a marvelous play if they'd gotten him at first.
If they'd have scored that in error, Griffin would have probably had in his next contract, I will never play shortstop when Mark Lemke played. Here's Glavine. He sacrificed back in the fifth, pushed it toward third, and you'd figure him to do it again, though in that spot, he showed bunt and then tried to slap one past the drawn in infield. The stretch. He is bunting, and he pops it up, and nobody can get there, and it's 0-1.
Just doing a little arithmetic on Tom Glavine with the pitching that he's done tonight, allowing one run in eight innings. His earned run average right now is at 2.00. That's the best in the National League. If he gets him out in the ninth inning without giving up a run, the ERA will be 1.98, and that would be one more category that Glavine would lead the league in, at least momentarily. Ramon Martinez would have a chance to surpass him on Sunday.
Dennis Martinez pitched and won tonight for Montreal. That's 10 wins for him. This would be 12 for Glavine. He bunts, and it's a good one. Cook has one play to make. Runner at second, one down. And the Braves trying to add on here. A 1-4 sacrifice, and
Nixon
and Sanders will have a chance to plate some insurance. We mentioned it earlier, but I guess it bears repeating a couple things about the All-Star game. Number one, again, congratulations to Dave Pursley, the Atlanta trainer, one of two National League trainers who will work that game. And Pursley and Glavine leave on a flight around 10 o'clock Sunday night and get to Toronto at 6 a.m. Monday.
I think the workout begins at 2.
Perfect.
Monday. That'll be a long day for him because the All-Star game is really two full days of activities. They have both teams work out in the afternoon. They have a big party at night with live entertainment. They have the luncheon on All-Star game day when they present the All-Star rings, and then the game itself.
Nixon, a 391 hitter from the right side. A little low that time. One ball, no strikes. He hits the ball with a good deal more authority as a right-hand hitter. They play him around toward right, not very deep. Dion would be next. There's a strike inside corner, one and one. Third base coach Jimmy Williams has virtually his back turned to home plate as he helps Mark Lemke get a good lead at second base. Just missed. Two balls, one strike. There's the insurance run, standing at second. And there's Williams. He's in a rather vulnerable position. Hot foul to the right, not a play. Count evens, two and two.
Somebody ought to take a photograph of Jimmy Williams in that position and use Satchel Paige's quote, don't look over your shoulder, something may be gaining on you.
Two balls, two strikes. 4-8-0 for Atlanta, 1-7-2 for the Dodgers. Chop towards short. Griffin, good play. Throws close. Got it. Runner moves to third, but now there are two outs, and it's up to the left-hand hitter, Deion Sanders.
Deion Sanders.
Deion is 0 for 3 on the night. He's been on base a couple of times. Once he reached after striking out a pass ball by Carter. He walked on another appearance. He is 3 out of 20 since being recalled from Richmond. And up there against a lefty this time. I'd like to see him hit one hard into right center just so we could watch him run. There's a lot of room out there. Fastball over the inside corner. Sanders not too sure about that. 0-1. Pendleton would be next. 4-1 Atlanta, top of the ninth. Ground ball should end the inning. Sam Wells throws him out. So the leadoff single comes to nothing. One hit, no runs, no errors, one left. Go to the bottom of the ninth. Last chance for the Dodgers, who trail our Braves 4-1. There's the story as we go to the bottom half of the ninth inning. Tom Glavin has been brilliant. He seeks his sixth complete game, and this his 17th start. And he's three outs away, and he faces a tough hitter to lead it off, Eddie Murray, but a guy who's really struggling. Four of his last 47.
Murray, first base.
Murray stands in there. We're hoping the only fireworks the Dodger fans tonight will come after the game. Glavin's kept it that way to this point. Inside, one ball, no strikes. Juan Berenguer, it looks like, up in the Atlanta bullpen. And Kent Merker may be working with him. It's out of our line of sight. The 1-0 pitch. There's that change of pace again. I thought he'd lost something on it in the seventh, but whatever it was, either I was wrong, which is likely, or he's gotten it back. A ball and a strike. There it is again. He threw it twice in a row. This time Murray fouled it weakly back.
You saw that line on Tom Glavine. Needs one more strikeout for double figures. He had never accomplished that in the major leagues before until this year. He has done it three times already this year. He struck out 10 Dodgers on April 23rd, 10 Giants on May 24th, and 12 Phillies on June 19th.
Again, Murray stays alive. It's still 1-2. Up on the Atlanta dugout to get that foul ball, and now I guess he's being ejected, and the crowd is up in arms. The 1-2 pitch. Did he go? No. 2-2. The 2-2 pitch is on the way. Got it. Boy, he is pitching some game, and there's that double figures Pete was talking about.
Eddie Murray now over his last 21. He's really struggling. Fourth time this year that Glavine has struck out 10 or more in one game.
Cal Daniels is the batter. He makes it look so easy, Glavine does.
He's only thrown 104 pitches, and usually when you strike out a lot, by the time you get to the ninth inning, you're up around 125, 130 pitches. But his control is so excellent.
Here's a fastball by Daniels, 0-1. Look where limpy he's playing. 5 years ago, you couldn't do that. When Daniels had all his speed, limpy's out in short right field. A little bit inside. It's 1-1. Glavine has pitched 25 in the third innings this year against the Dodgers. 27 strikeouts and no walks. One ball, two strikes. Fouled a fastball up into the second deck. They must have a heck of a fireworks show here because nobody has left this park. And that's very unlike that stadium. The 1-2. Fouled it off his body at home plate. Count stays the same. Vault of Horror is the movie presentation after the game. Terry Thomas stars in Vault of Horror. As pictured here.
That's also what these parking lots are going to look like about 45 minutes after this game ends.
Exactly right, Professor. The 1-2 pitch, here it is. Long fly ball, well hit left field. Sanders going back. That ball is off the wall. The throw to second. It's close. He is safe. This thing isn't over yet. Daniels hits one halfway up the left field wall. And Dion almost cut him down.
It's Daniels' eighth double of the year, and Dion Sanders with a much better throwing arm than most left fielders. He can play right field. He's got a good throwing arm for a right fielder. Look how close he makes that play a second. And how accurate that throw was when Sanders had to play to Karam, quickly turn him for it. Still right on the money.
Gary Carter has been a problem for Glavine. He is 2 out of 3. He is 8 out of 21 in his career against him. So. At the knees, 0-1. That was a change. Daniels at second. He'll play it very conservatively. Strike. One more base runner brings a potential tying run to the plate.
Jimmy Williams signaling Otis Nixon to play a little more shallow in right field.
Ground ball, the third batter. It always happens in this ballpark. Tying run comes to the plate. They call it a boot, but that was a tough hop for Pendleton.
You see quite a few bad hops on this very hard surface Dodger infield. And you saw one here. Pendleton down on one knee, and there's the bad hop. The ball coming up on him. Came off his chest and caromed off to his left. By the time he recovered, he had no play. Runners first and second.
Tying run at the plate, Mike Sharperson, who has one home run this year. Griffin is scheduled to hit next. Change of pace, outside corner, nothing and one. Sharperson tonight has doubled, bounced to third, and singled. As Pete pointed out, it's the lower end of the order that has caused Glavin his troubles tonight. Just missed the inside corner. One and one, the count. Well, a double play gets us out of here. As we mentioned, Behringer and Merker are ready if needed. If you're a manager, the way this guy's pitched all year, it's tough to go out and get him. The 1-1 pitch. Swung and missed that change again. It's 1-2.
We talked about his composure a little bit earlier. This is where he really shows it. You'd see a lot of veteran starting pitchers who would get rattled in a spot like this. An error committed in the ninth inning, a tying run coming to the plate. But you don't see any change in Glavin's composure out on the mound or the way he goes about his business. Still making quality pitches.
The 1-2. Ground ball towards short. Throw to second out there. Throw to first. Safe there. It wasn't hit quite hard enough. Lemke did a heck of a job of turning it. Made it closer than I thought it would be at first.
Not really a double play ball. Big high hopper to short. Belliard gets it to second. Lemke able to turn it so quickly because Gary Carter doesn't have much speed at all. And didn't get down there until Lemke had released the ball. Griffin. It was a close play at first, but not in time.
So Alfredo Griffin is the batter. He is 0 for 2 tonight with a sacrifice fly and an RBI. He has not yet hit a home run this year. Mitch Webster has moved on deck. The recently acquired outfielder. He would pinch hit next. On the corner, nothing and one. Griffin didn't think so. The 0-1 pitch. That one missed outside of 1-1. The outfield shades Griffin around toward right. They play very shallow, especially in center and right. The 1-1. He tries to find his way on, fouls it back. A ball and two strikes. That's not a bad play for him. He knows he's not a home run threat.
I don't think Tommy Lasorda was too pleased with it, though.
A ball and two strikes.
I think he was most upset with the fact that the pitch was about a foot and a half outside the plate.
That part, you can see his point. Runner goes from first, fouled away. Sharperson will return. His run means nothing, but they're conceding him second base. That's one of those plays, if this pitch is a ball, that the scorer can call a stolen base or catcher's indifference. The 1-2. Griffin stays alive. He's the kind of guy a good control pitcher is frustrated by because he has no discernible strike zone. He'll swing at pitches at his shoes and up in his eyes at times.
A ball and two strikes. Didn't miss by much. 2-2. That was that change again. Into the dirt. Throws the ball. It hit the umpire straight at home plate. Full count. 3-2. On the play, Sharperson winds up at second. And they give him a stolen base. Glavin is yet to walk a batter tonight. The former Pirate, Cub, and Indian, Mitch Webster, waits on deck. And the 3-2 pitch. Line drive, twisting, fouled on the right side. It's still 3-2. A pretty good duel brewing here.
Blavin's had to throw more pitches in this inning than any of the previous eight. This will be his 28th pitch of the inning.
The 3-2. Here it is. He locked in and the bases are loaded. And Bobby Cox is on the top step. He's going to wait for Webster to be announced before he does whatever he plans to do here. Webster is a switch hitter. And here comes Cox. That's about as quickly as he can walk. He's gone through some knee surgery. And he hasn't yet signaled to his bullpen. He may talk first to Olsen and Glavin. You can see Glavin say, "I feel fine." And I'm going to first guess this move and say I'm all in favor of it, no matter what happens.
Well, he's your horse. He's the guy that's going to get you, keep you from having long losing streaks and get you through complete games. He's done it already this year, more times than he ever has in the past. Five complete games this year. He only had eight in his entire career prior to this year. The only time you take him out in that situation, I agree, is if he says he's out of gas. And he didn't say that.
And I think he would if he felt he was. Well, here we go. Outside, nowhere near. One ball, no strikes. Brett Butler would be next. It's a hot, muggy night here in Los Angeles. Maybe it's taking its toll. Swung and missed with 1-1. He had a good cut.
Mitch Webster is 0-2 since coming over to the Dodgers. Jose Gonzalez, who he was traded for, was 0-28. So that 25th spot on the roster for the Dodgers, 0-30 this year.
He's staying at our hotel until he gets a place here. We may have to bar him if he doesn't make out. A ball and a strike. Just missed. Two balls, one strike, and he's getting things up a little bit. And this is the man he has to get. If he loses Webster, somebody else will probably finish it up. Three and one. That missed low. This guy does have home run power. Great play, brave win. Belliard with a super play, and look at Glavin grab his hand. What a play he made. That ball looked like trouble. Look at it again here. This is a super play.
That's a great play. That ball taking that high hop. Belliard plays it on the short hop and rifles it over to first. Webster runs pretty well. Terrific play by Belliard. Glavin leads the league now in three categories. He leads the league in wins with 12. He leads the league in complete games with 6. And he leads the league in earned run average, 1.98.
And you see his first move is to his shortstop, Rafael Belliard, after that outstanding play. Had him all the time. Braves win at 4-1. Totals and highlights after this.
Fireworks show here at Dodger Stadium, and the fans are allowed on the field to watch the fireworks here. That's why all those people are out there in the outfield as we wrap it up here tonight. It was a pitcher's battle between Tim Belcher of the Dodgers and Tom Glavine of the Braves. 1-1 going to the top half of the sixth inning. A man aboard, Jeff Blauser at the plate, and he connects for his 7th homer of the year. Ronnie Gant scoring ahead of him. That broke the 1-1 deadlock. The Braves added one more run in the 7th. Tom Glavine pitched out of a bases-loaded spot in the bottom half of the 9th inning. And the Braves are 4-1 winners in the first game of this series. 4 runs, 8 hits, 1 error for Atlanta. The Braves left 7. 1 run, 8 hits, 2 errors for the Dodgers. Los Angeles left 8. Glavin all the way for the win. He's now 12-4. We told you about the categories he now leads the league in. Glavin tonight striking out 10 more. He leads the league in strikeouts, complete games, and wins. The losing pitcher, Tim Belcher, his record goes to 7-5. The Braves are now 7.5 games behind the Dodgers in the National League West. Other scores tonight in the National League, it was the New York Mets over the Phillies 3-1. Howard Johnson, 2 more RBIs. Dwight Gooden got the win. Danny Cox was the loser. John Franco a save. Montreal snapped an 11-game losing streak. Dennis Martinez won his 10th, 4-3 over the Pirates. Cubs over the Cardinals 5-1. Frank Castillo got his first major league win. Jose De Leon, the loser for St. Louis. Chris Hammond and Rob Dibble shut out Houston 1-0, a 5-hitter for them. Hammond got the win, Dibble the save. Pete Harnisch was the loser. He also pitched a 5-hitter, and it was San Diego over the Giants tonight, 4-2. The Giants have lost 4 straight at home now. Ed Whitson got the win over the rookie Mike Remlinger. Over in the American League, the Yankees saw their 6-game winning streak end. Baltimore beat them 7-4. In Cleveland, it was Milwaukee over the Indians, 4-2. The Indians have now lost 25 of their last 30. Kevin Morton made his major league debut, a winning one for the Red Sox. He pitched a 5-hitter, 10-1. Jack Clark drove in 7 Boston runs, equaling his career high in a game. Chicago beat Minnesota 4-2. McDowell got the win over Morris. Robin Ventura homered for the White Sox. Texas shut out California. Jose Guzman got the win there. Downing and Gonzalez homering for Texas. It was Oakland over Kansas City 9-3. Andy Hawkins beating Flash Gordon. A grand slam for Jose Canseco in that one. And a final in now from Seattle, where Toronto wins another close one. 2-1. Stottlemyre the winner over Holman.
And here the Braves and Tom Glavine beat the Dodgers 4-1. Same two teams tomorrow night, a half hour earlier. We'll have it for you at 10 o'clock Eastern Time. John Smoltz against Oral Hershiser. Vault of Horror with Terry Thomas is our movie presentation next. For Pete Van Wehr and Don Sutton, our entire TBS crew from Los Angeles, Skip Caray. So long, everybody.